Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Bande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namatarakshasantakam Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 34, Emblem of Mercy, Kaakaasura Vritaanta. That's the topic of today. We saw that Hanuman searched in the nooks and corners of the city of Lanka and finally found Sita Devi in the Ashoka Vana. And there, Hanuman witnessed her being tormented by the ogresses under the order of Ravana in order to make Sita accept Ravana's proposal. Sita was absolutely shattered with the situation and she felt no hope and she almost was about to give up her life when Hanuman sang the Ramayana and revived back all her hope and lit the lamp of happiness back in her heart. He jumped down, met Sita and introduced himself as the messenger of Rama. Sita wanted to confirm that Hanuman was indeed a messenger of Rama and not Ravana disguised as a monkey. So, in order to validate himself, Hanuman told Sita Devi certain aspects about Rama and Lakshmana. He described how Rama and Lakshmana looked, and this description instilled confidence into Sita Devi that this Hanuman was indeed a messenger of Sri Rama. Hanuman describes Rama as the one who has eyes resembling a lotus petal and his countenance resembles the full moon. Rama Kamala Patrakshaha Purna Chandra Nibhananaha Rupa Dakshinya Sampannaha Prasuto Janakatmaje. He is richly endowed with charm and prosperity right from his birth. He has broad shoulders, mighty arms, a conch-shaped neck and a very charming personality. Vipulamso Mahabahuhu Kumbhagrivaha Shubhananaha Gudhajatruhu Sutamraksho Ramonama Janeshrutaha. People know him by the name Rama. Satya Dharma Rata Shriman Sangraha Nugrahe Rataha Deshakala Vibhagagnya Sarvaloka Priyamvadaha. He is devoted to truth and righteousness and remains intent on accumulating wealth and power for the purpose of showering favor on people. He knows the right use of time and place and speaks kindly to all people. Now all these attributes that Hanuman enlisted here were all exclusive to Sri Rama. And as and when he went on uttering these words, Sita Devi's heart started beating back to the fullest again, it seems. Till then, she was hardly surviving. But these words brought life back to Sita Devi. And she really felt happy looking at Hanuman. She narrates how she had been abducted by Ravana and how Ravana had given her a month's time, after which he was planning to kill her because anyway she was not going to accept his proposal. So, she told Hanuman that I could not bear to listen to these words of his repeatedly and I was almost about to give up my life myself. But Now, after seeing you, I have hope that you will go and tell Rama of my plight here and bring him here immediately, as soon as possible, defeat this Ravana and take me back to his own self. Now, Hanuman was unable to see this distress of Sita. And so, he offered to carry her on his back to the presence of Sri Rama. And he somehow felt that maybe Sita Devi was wondering how such a small monkey could do such a big task. So it seems Hanuman showed his gigantic form to Sita and said, "Do not worry, I am this big, I can carry you across the ocean to the presence of Rama." To this Sita Devi replied, "See Hanuman, that's not becoming of me and you. If I go with you, then what will the world say of my master Rama? I was abducted by an ogre and my husband did not come personally to save me. Instead, he sent a messenger. I do not want that defame to come on my husband. It would be only proper for him to take up all his arms, defeat this ruler of Lanka and take me back to his own self. Sharast sankulam kritva lankam parabalardhanaha mam nayeta yadika kuchtaha tattasya sadrisham bhavet." This is what would be becoming of Rama. This is what would be suitable for Rama's valor and strength to come and save me personally. So I cannot come with you, O Hanuman, but do go and tell Rama that I am here waiting for him to return very desperately. So tell him to collect all forces, come here and redeem me from this trouble as soon as possible. Then Hanuman asked Sita for a token to be taken back to Rama. He had handed over the token that Rama had sent with him, Rama's signet ring. Rama trusted that Hanuman would find Sita and so had given his signet ring only to Hanuman amongst all the monkeys who went for search. And Hanuman here handed over that ring to Sita, which really brought tremendous joy to this troubled heart of Sita. And now Hanuman wanted a token to be taken back to be given to Rama. Here, Sita very beautifully said that, "As a token, I will narrate a story to you, which you shall go and tell to Rama, and Rama will know that you have met me and I have conveyed things to you." And then she said, "Along with the story, I will also give you a material token. I'll give you my head ornament, Chudamani. You can take that and you can give it to Rama. But along with that, I want you to narrate this story to Rama to remind him of his valor and strength and yet being compassionate to people and how I enjoyed that nature of his and how much I'm missing him. All this will be conveyed in this story," she said. "What was this story?" Sita said, "It so happened that when we were residing in the Chitrakuta mountain, we were very happily sporting in the river Mandakini. And after a while, both of us were tired. And so initially I slept on the lap of Rama for some time. And before I was going to sleep, I saw a wretched crow looking at me with lustful eyes. And after that, I went back to sleep. After a while, I got up and it was the turn of Rama to sleep on my lap. So he slept off. At that time, that same wicked crow came down flying from the tree and he tried to peck at me. Picking up a clod of earth, I tried to shoo away that crow. But it kept on coming back to me again and again. And it hurt my chest so much that blood started oozing out of it. I did not want to wake up Rama and disturb his beautiful sleep. He was looking so handsome as he slept. I did not have the heart to wake him up. So I silently bore what the crow did. But as blood started oozing out, it touched the forehead of Rama. And that warm touch of this liquid suddenly woke him up. And he was incensed to see me like this with blood oozing all over me. And then he spoke very
angrily, hissing like a venomous serpent. By whom have your chests been hurt like this? Who is this who has the daring to play a foul play like this with his wife of Rama? He turned his head as he said these words and he saw that notorious crow having blood on his beaks because of creating this wound. Rama immediately realized he was the culprit and he took a blade of grass beside him. He pulled it out and programmed it as the Brahmastra and threw it on the crow. Rama was such an archer that he could convert a mere blade of grass into the greatest of missiles, the Brahmastra. He did that and this Brahmastra started chasing the bird. This bird was no ordinary bird. He was Kaakaasura, named Jayanta. Actually, he was the son of Indra, who because of a curse had taken up this form. And so he had contacts in the other worlds. He knew the Devas, he knew Brahma, he knew Indra, he knew Shiva. So it is said that he flew around all the three worlds, seeking refuge from everybody. Treen lokan samparikramya. But nothing happened. Everybody said, no, this is a missile which has been programmed by Rama. We dare not try to combat that. We do not have the competence to do so. And if Rama has thought that you are his enemy and he is trying to send an arrow to kill you, we will not stand against it also, because we knew that Rama is known for his righteousness. So you must have done some wrong. And we are not even in a position to save you because we are powerless against this missile of Rama. So please go back. So this crow, Kaakaasura, traveled all the three worlds and finding no other refuge, he came back to Rama's holy feet. Streenlokan samparikramya tameva sharanam gataha satam nipatitam bhumau sharanya sharanagatam. He came and fell at the feet of Rama, having no other go. Now, all this while, this Brahmastra of Rama was only chasing Kaakaasura. Rama is such an archer that he could have got his target at the first go. Was it so difficult for Rama's arrow to go and pierce Kaakaasura the moment it was left on him? Not at all. But Rama chose to give Kaakaasura a chance to come back and surrender to him, because Sita Devi was present with him at that time. This is what we had explained when we were discussing the Dhyana Shloka of Ramayana, when the words Vaidehi Sahitam came. Whenever we think of Rama, we should always think of him as the one associated with Vaidehi, that is Sita. Because when Sita is with him, then there is a chance that we find refuge in Rama if we come back with good sense. And that good sense can get instilled into us because of the grace of Devi Sita. It is said in the Padma Purana that when Kaakaasura came and fell at the feet of Rama, he fell out of exhaustion. He did not even see where Rama's feet were and all. He just came and fell without any go. He came back to the place from where he had started. It is said that the crow fell with its legs facing the legs of Rama. If someone were to surrender to another person, his head would be at the feet of the person whom he is surrendering to. But this Kaakaasura fell the other way. He fell with his feet at Rama's feet. It is said in the Padma Purana that Sita Devi was so gracious, so compassionate, that she turned the head of Kaakaasura towards the feet of Rama, so that it would appear that he is surrendering to him. And that Rama, who is the compassionate mate of Sita, forgave him, spared his life, though he was actually fit to be slain. Vadharham apika kutstaha kripaya paryapalayata. He was fit to be slain, but Rama decided not to do that. Instead, he needed something for his arrow. Now, Rama's arrows never go waste. So, they needed a target. So, Rama chose to take away one eye of that Kaakaasura, the right eye of Kaakaasura. But even though he took away the right eye of Kaakaasura, he gave him a boon saying that you will be able to look at both sides with one eye itself. So actually this punishment was not even given fully. Even this diluted punishment was not given fully to the crow. Though he had lost one of his eyes, he still had the power to look at both sides with a single eye. Now looking at this grace of Rama, it seems this Kaakaasura hailed saying, Kaha Rama, Ka Seetha, Ka Kaha, Ka Kaha. He started shouting, meaning, who can be like this Rama, who can be like this Seetha? They are all uniquely great in showering compassion and affection on people. So saying, he uttered Ka Kaha and flew away. And it is said that from that day onwards, all crows crow out as Kaaka, Kaaka. This story, now Sita is narrating to Hanuman as an emblem to be given to him. Hanuman asked for a token to be given to Rama, and Sita Devi narrated this story as a token. This incident she wanted to remind Rama and remind him of his valor of being capable of doing away with enemies, however powerful they were, and making them run through all the three worlds. So was it so difficult for him to come here and save her? She wanted to remind him of that. And so she spoke about this story of his, where he had shown his valor and his merciful character. This entire episode is very beautifully summarized in the Periyarvar Thirumoli, when Alvar says, Chittira kootat thiruppa sirukakkai mulai thinda Athirame konderiya anaitthulagum thirindodi Vittagane rama o ninnabayam enraipa Athirame adan kannai aruttadumo radayalam. This was a token which was given by Sita to Rama. It was an emblem. It was an adayalam, as they say. It was a mudra that Sita sent to Rama. Along with this story, she also sent her chudamani, which was to be given to Rama by Hanuman. Hanuman very happily listened to this story of the glory of Rama and Sita and was now all set to take back this token to Rama. But before that, he decided to have some fun in Lanka. So what Hanuman did, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agreva Chayati Prabhanjana Sute Tatvam Munibhyavparam Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 35. Seated on a hot plate. That is the topic of today. Hanuman met Sita Devi in the Ashoka Vana, and he reassured her that he would soon return with Lord Rama, who would rescue her after defeating the evil-minded Ravana. And from her, he received a token in the form of a story of Kaakaasura and also her head ornament, the Chudamani. Now, Hanuman's mission of being an envoy, a spy, a messenger, should have actually been considered completed with this. But it is said that a good messenger performs or delivers more than what he is expecting. And Hanuman was the best of messengers. Shri Ramadutam Shirasa Namami. He is known as, Hanuman is known as Ramaduta. And this Ramaduta was
the best amongst dutas, messengers. And what all did this duta achieve as a Rama duta? What all did Hanuman achieve? It is said, Ullanghya sindoho salilam salilam yashokavannam janakatmajayaha adaya tenaiva dadahalankam namamitam pranjali ranjaneyam. Hanuman crossed the ocean. He found Sita. He met her and actually cooled her fire of sorrow. He cooled down her burning heart with his message from Rama. And then he did another very important thing. It is said that he destroyed the city of Lanka by burning it. And that is one of the major feats of Hanuman as Rama's messenger. Now, how did this come about? Hanuman wanted to see the power of the enemy before going away from his land. He came searching for Sita. Now he found her and he knew that there was a war coming up because Sita had to be redeemed. And the only way she could be redeemed was by Rama fighting with Ravana. So when there is a war around the corner, an intelligent spy would try to gauge the strengths and weaknesses of the enemy's army. So Hanuman wanted to know the strength of the ogres in Lanka. And he also wanted to see this fellow called Ravana, who is supposed to be such a powerful king and who is so heartless that he is troubling a noble lady like Sita like this. So in order to have a first-hand information about all this, Hanuman decided to play a prank. He started destroying the Ashoka grove. He wanted to be noticed and he wanted to be taken to the presence of Ravana. So how to make himself noticed? By doing some notorious act. So he started pulling out the creepers. He started shaking up the trees so that all the fruits fell down. And he started laying waste that royal pleasure garden called the Ashokavana. And on the ogresses asking who he was, he did not reply at all. And in fact, he tried to frighten them away with his very funny yet scary pranks. Now these ogresses went and directly reported to Ravana that there was a monkey trying to destroy their Ashokavana. These ogresses all had a doubt on Sita too, whether this monkey was known to Sita. When Sita was interrogated about this, she chose to remain ignorant about the entire fact. She did not give any positive reply. So these ogresses reported the matter to Ravana, and Ravana disposed his kinkaras, the ogres who were present in his court, immediately to go and take care of the situation. Hanuman immediately made short work of them. He disposed these kinkaras so easily. And then next he decided to demolish a temple kind of a thing, which had the guardian deity of the ogres. He climbed up on it, killed the guards posted there, and he exhibited his prowess all the time, uttering the name Shri Rama in a thundering voice. He uprooted a pillar from that temple, and then he tried to burn down the entire temple itself. By now, Ravana had sent one of his able ogres named Jambumali, who came and offered combat to Hanuman and was ultimately killed by Hanuman. Then Ravana sent his own son Akshakumara, and Hanuman did away with him also. Akshakumara too was slain. Then finally Ravana dispatched Indrajit, his first son, also known as Meghanada. And Indrajit had a detailed fight with Hanuman, and he realized that Hanuman could not be handled with any other missile but the Brahmastra. So he used the Brahmastra, and Hanuman acted as if he was bound by the Brahmastra. Hanuman had a boon from Brahma that the Brahmastra would not harm him in any way. But when Indrajit used the Brahmastra, Hanuman decided to succumb to it, because only then would he be taken to the court of Ravana. And he wanted to now see the power of Ravana. by having these fights with these augurs, he had tested the enemy's strengths. He knew how these augurs would fight now. He had a fair idea. Now his next move was to go and see Ravana in person. It is said that Hanuman was dragged into the court of Ravana and he saw Ravana in front of him, and actually he was awestruck by the presence of Ravana.
He thought, what charm, what presence of mind, what courage, what splendor, and what combination of all auspicious bodily marks is present in this king of augurs. Aho rupam, aho dhairyam, aho sattvam, aho dyutihi, aho rakshasarajasya sarvalakshana yuktata. Only if he had resorted to the path of righteousness, he could have actually been a protector of even heavens, which is ruled by Indra. Yadya dharmo na balavan syadayam rakshaseshwaraha syadayam suralokasya sashakrasya pirakshita. Had his mind been not away from righteousness, his power and status would have been something else. He's such a wonderful personality to look at and seems so in intellect too. But unfortunately, he has resorted to unrighteousness. And when unrighteousness is around, no other quality comes to the rescue. Nothing else can be put to use when one is unrighteous. So Hanuman saw Ravana, and Ravana was very irritated to see a monkey having destroyed his beautiful Ashokavana. So he spoke harsh words to him and he asked him who he was and what was the purpose of his having come there. Hanuman very beautifully gave him a reply. He told him, O Ravana, I am the messenger of your brother Sugriva. I am his minister and I have come as a messenger of his on behalf of Sri Rama. And how he spoke about Sugriva, he said, Sugriva is your brother Ravana. Aham Sugriva Sandeshadiha Praptastvantike Rakshasesha Harishastvam Bhrata Kushalam Abravit. I am the minister and messenger of Sugriva, and this brother Sugriva of yours inquires about your welfare. Now, how did Sugriva become Ravana's brother? There's a story behind this, that once upon a time, Ravana tried to defeat Vali and he went seeking combat with Vali to Kishkinda. Because Ravana had the ego of being powerful so much on his head that he wanted to fight with anybody who was claimed powerful by the world. And the world claimed that Vali was a very powerful king. So Ravana desired to have combat with Vali. So he went to Kishkinda, and when he went to Kishkinda, he was told that Vali was not there at that time and he had gone to perform his evening prayers. And Vali would perform his evening prayers in all the four oceans. He would fly across all the four oceans and complete his evening prayers, Sandhya Vandana. So Ravana went in search of Vali to one of the ocean shores and he found him there. And he thought he would attack Vali from behind. But Vali was so vigilant that he caught hold of Ravana under his arms. And it seems he flew over all the four oceans to complete his evening prayers, all the time holding Ravana under his arms. That was the power of Vali. Ravana was so terrified of this power of Vali that he decided to befriend Vali. And at the time of seeking friendship with Vali, Ravana called out to Vali as his brother. And so there was apparent brotherhood between Ravana and Vali. So the brother of Vali, the actual brother of Vali, Sugriva, also became the brother of Ravana. So here Hanuman says, your brother Sugriva inquires about your welfare. Not only that, Hanuman wanted to convey a message by calling Ravana as Sugriva's brother. Hanuman was so intelligent at talking that he always had some inner meaning and inner sense which was hiding in his words.
he called Sugriva the brother of Ravana. And Sugriva had become the brother of Rama by befriending him. When Rama and Sugriva became friends, Rama said, "You're as good as my brother, as my Lakshmana, as my Bharata, as my Shatrughna, as my Guha. So you're also my sibling like these, and with you we become six siblings in all. The four original sons of Dasharatha plus Guha plus Sugriva." So Sugriva was also considered a brother of Rama. So if you are Sugriva's brother, then you also become a brother of Rama. And how can you abduct your own brother's wife? That is so wrong. So Hanuman wanted to convey this and try to put some sense into Ravana. So he called out to him as Sugriva's brother, and that Sugriva inquired of his welfare and said that he has sent this following message to you, that you have abducted the queen of Rama, the wife of Rama, which is a gravely unrighteous act. So we request you to return back the wife of Rama to him in order to avoid any kind of unpleasantness. If you wish to have peace in your kingdom, if you wish to survive, then you better return back Sita to Rama. So during the conversation, Hanuman built the seriousness and finally told him on a candid note that he had to return Sita. Ravana was very irritated listening to this, and to crown it all, Hanuman started singing the glory of Rama at the end. He said, "If you do not return Sita, then you're done for. You do not know the glory and valor of Rama." So saying, he started singing the praise of Rama, which irritated Ravana even more. And he said, "Now, I don't want to hear any more from you, O monkey. I will slay you." At this time, Vibhishana, the younger brother of Ravana, intervened and said, "It is very wrong to kill a messenger. That's against the Shastras. So you must not do it." So finally, Ravana decided to set fire to the tail of Hanuman. Hanuman quietly agreed to everything. He was watching with a lot of fun. He wanted to assess how each augur was. And now in this court of Ravana, he was getting a fair idea by listening to the conversation between these augurs. He realized that Vibhishana was a Dharmatma, and how Ravana was such an impatient king. All the impression that he had got by seeing Ravana for the first time was slowly dwindling down looking at his behavior. So finally, they set the tail Hanuman to fire by soaking it in oil. And Hanuman acted as if that fire was burning him. As we had seen in one of the previous episodes, Hanuman had a boon from the fire god that fire would not burn him up. To add on to the power of this boon, it is said that the news of Hanuman's tail being set to fire reached the Ashokavana, reached the ears of Sita Devi, and Sita Devi personally prayed to the fire god as to not to scorch Hanuman. So as an effect of that too, Hanuman felt no uneasiness because of the fire set to his tail, but he acted as though he was getting burnt, and he started jumping around. As a monkey, he was very good at jumping. So as he started jumping over each and every house of the city of Lanka, the entire city of Lanka was set ablaze. He set fire to the entire city of Lanka, it is said, barring the house of Vibhishana, and he could now see the golden city of Lanka burning away to ashes. It is said that even the gods, the devas, saw this from the heavens, and they were all so happy that the city of Ravana is now getting burnt. As this burning episode was happening, Hanuman suddenly realized, "Oh my God, I have set fire to everywhere in Lanka. What if the Ashokavana also gets burnt? Oh my God, what have I done? What will happen to Sita Devi?" So saying, he approached himself and was overwhelmed with grief. At this time, he heard
voices from the heavens, from the lips of Siddhas and Charanas, saying that nothing has happened to the Ashokavana, it's safe and sound, and Sita Devi is absolutely in safe quarters. Hanuman heaved a sigh of relief, and then he started enjoying the sight of the Lanka being burnt once again. He was amused with himself with the way he set fire to Lanka. He behaved as though he was seated on a hot plate and he was jumping around from here to there. Finally, then he went and dipped his tail in the ocean and was ready to go back on his journey to give the good news that he had found Sita. How he conveyed the news, we shall see in the next part.
Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Bande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Sustitam Agre Vachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakshantam Bharatadibhihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam.
The Ramayana series, part 36. Nectar for Rama. Dhrushta Seetha. This is the topic of today. Rama's messenger Hanuman came all the way to Lanka to find Sita Devi kept in the Ashoka grove by the wicked Ravana. Hanuman met Sita Devi, comforted her and instilled confidence into her that Rama was soon coming to rescue her, and took her chudamani or the head jewel and a beautiful story to be told to Rama as a token of his having met Sita. And then he wanted to assess the powers of the enemy before going back. So he went to destroy the Ashoka grove. He played havoc at the Ashoka grove and was imprisoned by Indrajit into the shackles of the Brahmastra. And when Hanuman, thus tied with the Brahmastra, was taken to the presence of Ravana, he tried to put some sense into the head of Ravana, which was futile. And so Ravana wanted to punish Hanuman and set fire to his tail. That very fire set by Ravana burnt his own city Lanka, because fire was not to affect Hanuman in any way, because of a boon that he had received and because of the blessings that Sita Devi gave him by praying to the fire god. After having burnt the city of Lanka and feeling triumphant, Hanuman decided to return to his lord to tell him the good news of having found Sita. So he leapt from the coast of Lanka and he just touched the Mainaka mountain, the very same mountain which tried to offer him hospitality as he was flying towards Lanka. It is said that on his way back too, he touched that mountain as a mark of respect and went. And the next step that he kept was on the Mahindra mountain, from where he had taken off. Such was the great power of Hanuman that in a single leap, he crossed the ocean, and his very sight and the expression of joy lit on his face reassured the monkeys that Hanuman had returned with success. Jambavan saw Hanuman's expression and he told all the monkeys that it's time for us to celebrate, give out a jubilant roar. I can see that Hanuman has returned successful. Having greeted Jambavan and others after alighting from the Mahindra mountain, Hanuman narrates to them in a nutshell
as to how he discovered Sita, and everybody started applauding Hanuman for his great achievement. Following that, he also told them the very sad picture of Sita at the Ashoka Grove, and all the monkeys really felt for her at that time, it seems. In fact, it is said that Prince Angada wanted to immediately march to Lanka and exterminate the whole race of Rakshasas and bring back Sita and restore her to Rama. Such was his enthusiasm and eagerness to defeat that foe who caused so much pain to Sita Devi. But Hanuman and Jambavan convinced him that we should not do this on our own, but try to report to Rama, and we may not even be able to do it on our own. So let's go back and complete the task that is assigned to us. So all the monkeys set from the Mahendra mountain back towards Kishkinda. And it is said that on the way, they found a grove called Madhuvana. And this Madhuvana was filled with trees laden with fruits, all kinds of fruits. And it was very safely guarded by a monkey named Dadimukha. Not all were permitted to enter into that grove, but these monkeys, after having accomplished their mission successfully, they were so much intoxicated with joy that they just rushed into the Madhuvana. They were all hungry too, and one feels hungry after his task has been achieved. When a big task is going on, people do not feel hunger or thirst much, but once the task is completed, then all these bodily requirements start taking priority. So the monkeys were very hungry too. So they entered the Madhuvana and they partook the fruits there, the honey there, and they started singing and dancing like drunken people. And the guards of the grove came and tried to somehow drive these monkeys away. But they just hit back those guards and started enjoying all over again. Then finally, this Dadimukha went running to Sugriva to report to him that his army of monkeys, a troop of army of his monkeys, had become crazy and were destroying the Madhuvana. As soon as Sugriva heard this news, he understood that, okay, this must be the party from the south. They must have come back with good news. That is why they have entered the Madhuvana and they are having as much fun as possible in that. They would not have dared to do this had they not found success in their mission. So Sugriva predicted that they must have returned with the news that they have found Sita. Then he sent a message with Dadimukha to immediately bring those monkeys to his presence. And he told Dadimukha that please call them very fondly because I am sure they have achieved their purpose. Then Dadimukha understood that, okay, this is a celebration of success and that he should not be in their way. So he went and gave the message of Sugriva to Angada, and all the monkeys along with Angada, Jambava and Hanuman came to the presence of Sugriva. When they were entering itself, Sugriva was now completely confident that his intuition was right and they were returning successful. And as soon as they came, Hanuman uttered beautiful words saying that seen by me was Sita. Dhrushta Siteti Hanumat Vadanat Amritopamam Akaranya Vachanam Ramo Harshamapasa Lakshmanaha. He said, I have seen her, I have seen Sita. And listening to these words, Rama and Lakshmana experienced great delight because they were like nectar falling into their ears. Hanumat Vadanat Amritopamam. It was like Amrita coming and falling on their ears. Now here, the way these expressions were conveyed is of great importance. If somebody is coming with the news, then the most important part of the news should reach the audience first. Here, the aspect that was to be highlighted and emphasized was that they had seen Sita. So the word seen came before even uttering the word Sita. For example, if Hanuman had started with Seetha, Seetha was discovered by me, or Seetha has not yet been discovered by me, anything could have been said by him. So if the sentence started with the subject Seetha, then there was a chance of expecting either a positive statement after that, that is Seetha was seen by me, or a negative statement that Seetha has not yet been discovered by me. But Hanuman knew the condition of mind that Rama was in. He was just waiting to hear the good news that Seetha had been discovered. So he said, I saw, I have seen, it is success, it is job done. So he used the verb first instead of using the noun, instead of using the subject. He kept the object as priority because that was what Rama wanted to hear. Had he uttered just the name of the subject first, then for those few milliseconds, Rama's heart would have pounded, thinking what is going to come up next, whether he's going to say that he saw Seetha or he did not see Seetha. So it's better that we utter the verb first, is what was Hanuman's thought. And he said, Dhrushta Seetha. Seen by me was Seetha. Kandain Seethayai, says Kamba in his Ramayana. After this, Hanuman gave that token that Seetha had sent for Rama, her head jewel or chudamani, and Rama pressed it to his bosom and wailed out loudly. He was lamenting so much that it's all because of me that this daughter of Janaka, who's so used to comfort and pampering, has to suffer like this in the Ashoka Grove. So saying, he laments in many ways. And then Hanuman says, I have one more token to be conveying to you. Sita Devi told me the story that happened at Chitrakuta with Kaakaasura. And Hanuman reproduced at length the incident which was connected with that crow Kaakaasura, which was told to him by Seetha, and finally concluded saying that Seetha was desperately waiting for Rama to come himself and redeem her from this trouble. Ravana had given her a month's time and she had decided to give up her life in case Rama did not turn up by then. And Hanuman conveyed all this to Rama, and he also told him one more thing, that apparently Sita Devi had a doubt as to how Rama and his friends, now the clan of monkeys, would cross the ocean and come. To which Hanuman said, O Sita Devi, I am the weakest amongst monkeys in our clan. If I have been able to cross the ocean and come and see you, then everybody else will manage rather well. With these words of reassurance, Hanuman had come back, and that he uttered to Rama now. Rama felt so proud of Hanuman and he was overwhelmed with joy. He had no words to express his gratitude to Hanuman for what he had done. It is said by Srinidhi Swami in his Vanjuramayana that at that time, the best possible gift that was there with Rama was himself. So he offered himself, he offered his embrace to Hanuman as a gift at that time. Mudah janaki vrittam sada hariganarchitaha prapa sarvasvabhutam cha parishvangam raghuttamat. Hanuman was honored by all monkeys, told Rama the news about Sita with joy, and in turn he obtained from Rama the embrace of his, which was his only possession at that time, it seems. Rama told Hanuman, I wish to give you some gift, but I don't have anything with me now. All that I have is to give my affection to you completely through my embrace. And he very fondly and tightly embraced Hanuman. It is said that this was equivalent to emancipation for Hanuman. He felt it was mokshananda. What more could he ask for? Even that world of moksha was nothing compared to this moment when he got the embrace of Rama for him. So Hanuman, who gave the words of Dhrushta Sita as nectar to Rama, now received in return this nectar of embrace from Sri Rama. And he could ask for nothing more in life. He felt so content. After receiving this nectar-like news from Hanuman, now Rama said, it's time for action. And Sugriva too was all prepared to assist Rama and be with him to win back Sita. How they proceeded with the actual plan of going and waging a war against Ravana, we shall see in the next part.